sun's coming up.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Cosm Podcast. I'm your host, Tyler James Berger. I'm so excited to bring this podcast with David Rothenberg to you all. David is a musician, philosopher, author of Why Birds Sing, A Journey into the Mystery of Birdsong, as well as Survival of the Beautiful, which explores the interplay of beauty, art, and culture in the processes of evolution. He has also spent years playing music with animals, communicating with them through the language of music. It was fascinating to pick his brain in this interview. I learned so much, and I know you will too. So, without any further ado, please welcome David Rothenberg. So, I'm here with David Rothenberg. David, how are you doing? It's so good to have you on the Cosm Podcast.
Good. Thanks for inviting me. I'm doing fine. The rain has stopped. All the flowers are all opening up on all these amazing trees.
And, the birds are chirping.
The birds are quiet at the moment, but they will start chirping. Yeah, you'll hear them.
So, could you start by telling us a little bit about yourself and when you first became interested in the mysteries of birdsong?
Okay, well, I'm a musician and a philosopher and writer, and I'm very much involved with the sounds of the natural world. And one thing I like to do is play music live with singing birds and whales and insects, in that sense, really engage with these more than human musicians who are constantly making amazing music all around us that we usually don't take all that seriously. And so I really like to engage live in unpredictable circumstances and make music that no one species could make alone.
Mm. Wow. So when did you start playing music to birds?
I first got interested in this when I was in high school. I heard about Paul Winter. He lived pretty close to me in Connecticut. And this guy is a jazz musician who's built a whole career out of making music with sounds of the natural world. So I heard about him when I was pretty young. I thought that I could do something like that. That's kind of cool. I got to know him, met a lot of his musicians, and we're still friends. And it turns out that over the years, I always thought there must be thousands of people playing music with animals. There's actually not too many. There should be many more. Everyone should do it. But of course, you have to do it with a certain amount of respect and humility and openness to the unknown. You can't just expect it to go the way you want with these musicians. You can't tell them when to start and stop. So I think a certain kind of musician that likes the unpredictable nature of a strange, nearly impossible situation, they're the kind of people that get most into this.
Yeah. I mean, I love your work because you kind of go beyond typical evolutionary theories in explaining why birds sing. And you suggest that birds sing because they actually like to sing, that they have an aesthetic sense, you know? What is the evidence that birds sing for the joy of singing rather than just the typical explanations of finding a mate?
Okay, well, don't think that this is an unscientific view that I'm propagating here.
Certainly.
This is the original idea from Charles Darwin. You know, in The Descent of Man, he wrote two whole chapters on birds, and he says birds have a natural aesthetic sense. They appreciate beauty. Why else would they have evolved beautiful feathers and beautiful songs? It's not just survival of the fittest, and he knew that full well. That's why he wrote this book. You know, Origin of Species is about survival.
Yeah, he also said the view of the peacock's tail makes him sick.
That was in a letter he wrote to Asa Gray, a noted naturalist of the time. And he said, like, this is before he came up with that more eloquent aesthetic sense idea. It was really giving him some pause, some problems. It makes me sick. How could that evolve when nature is supposed to be all survival of the fittest? What a useless thing to carry around. What a lot of weight, what a lot of work to lug around this useless tail. Otherwise, you could be a fast flying bird in the forest. This peacock is dragged down by this thing. But it's after that that he thought of the idea of sexual selection and looked around at nature and said, there's a lot of beautiful stuff here that doesn't seem so useful. And then he had to revise his theories. And so, so that being said, the majority of evolutionary biologists today do not hold to Darwin's view. They would say that, okay, yeah, Darwin was right about a lot of things, but he was wrong about this. And the most popular idea about the peacock's tail or a beautiful bird song that you will hear in biology class today is that these things are an indicator of fitness, that they are honest signals, that the tail says, this peacock is strong, you should mate with him. This bird is the best, smartest, strongest bird because he has the best song, that they stand for something else. And that's what you'll learn in biology class. And and this is an idea that a handful of people will say, there's no evidence for that. You're just trying to make it simpler. You're trying to say beauty is a sense of fitness instead of the idea that evolution also produces weird, cool stuff, that it doesn't have this exact purpose. And Darwin said, look, a lot of things cannot be explained by this, but biology today wants to make everything seem useful. And this might, in fact, explain why not so many people study these kinds of things. It's not a popular place to go in biology. You know, you're not going to get a big career studying beautiful bird songs. You could do it, but, you know, this is not the mainstream. That being said, there's more and more biologists like Richard Prum at Yale University. He wrote a book, The Evolution of Beauty, in which he says, look, beauty is real. It's there. It evolves in nature. We've got to accept that. Mm-hmm. And so...
Wow.
Go figure, you know. And so these things are in flux. And the second thing you brought up is, you say birds sing for the joy of it, that they get pleasure. Okay, it's not only me that says that, but scientists like Eric Jarvis, who measures what goes on inside the brains of birds when they're singing.
Yes.
Dopamine is released. They're gaining pleasure from it. And, you know, nowhere in the history of biology did anyone ever assume that there was no pleasure in this. It's just there's too much talk about the pragmatics. And the function of the phenomenon is not the phenomenon. This is a philosophical basic idea. What the music is for is not the music. You know, I can put on some music for seductive purposes, but the music is not that seduction. You know, I'm using it. And the birds may be using this music for different things. And that's part of the thing that we often avoid the thing in itself. We want to know what it's for, what its purpose is. Why do birds sing? Well, we want a simple answer instead of what are they singing? What are they actually doing? Let's go deep into it and realize it's quite interesting. And most scientists, many poets, musicians are not listening. They just come with their fixed idea and they just offer their idea. They don't pay attention to a phenomenon that could change the way you see the world if you took it more seriously.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's definitely a lot of explaining away in the scientific community rather than explaining. I love this idea that you touched on with bird songs kind of being beautiful in and of themselves. I read in your book, Survival of the Beautiful, that you found a similarity in structure between bird song and whale songs, which is so mind-blowing to me, because one would think that if these songs are just the result of the process of random mutations selected over time, that the songs between different animals would be wildly divergent. But this isn't the case. It seems that there's an objective quality of beauty that animals seem to evolve towards and converge at, a sense of beauty that even is agreed upon between species. Are there rules governing the form of beauty? Can you explain this dynamic a little bit more?
Yeah, okay, so that's what this book, Survival of the Beautiful, is about, you know, the dichotomy between biology that says, like, anything goes, any trait might evolve and could be selected for. Why do turkeys have these big, ugly things dangling from their necks? Because the females happen to like this weird thing. It could be anything. The randomness is part of biology and evolution. But on the other hand, there's this notion of chemistry and physics, mathematics. The universe offers certain possible structures. Certain symmetries can be found. Others are not found. That's why Richard Prum pointed out there's 9 basic forms, patterns that can appear on feathers of any bird. That's all that chemistry can produce because of the way these patterns develop. That's it. It has to be a blend of one of these shapes. And he sort of describes that very clearly. So this is a dichotomy. What is possible? Is it random or is it constrained by the rules of nature? But then you go to these weird things like extremes. Extremes we're taught at some point. I don't know why we're taught this. Extremes make bad examples. So, okay, most whales are very silent, don't say much, or they talk back and forth with each other, except the humpback whale can sing a song that goes on for 24 hours. Okay, why? We don't know. They're not territorial. The males are doing it, so we assume it's to attract the attention of females. No human has ever seen a female whale show any interest in this. So maybe it's about something else. But they're doing it regardless, and it's very structured, very organized, very surprising. And if you speed it up, and I can send you this recording, it's easy to find, it's quite similar to the songs of certain nightingale species. The nightingale is also an outlier, a bad example. This bird sings all night, very stupid thing to do. An owl could go swoop you off a tree, and they sit in exposed places. Like, it's dumb, but they do it. It's somehow they've evolved to do this excessive behavior. We have no idea why. Similar birds don't sing that much, nothing so complicated. But the nature of what they're singing is somewhat similar in various different forms. And this really interests me. This really fascinates me. And it suggests that there's certain basic patterns that the brains of many different animals have access to, or other things they don't do. You know, it maybe is analogous to in human music. You know, we have certain rhythms you find all over the world. Certain pitches are used by many different cultures. Others are more obscure. There's a certain universal senses that humans have. Maybe animals share them, kinds of rhythm, things like that. And these, where they come from, might have to do something with how the universe is put together. You know, look at this artwork behind you. Has these repeating patterns, okay? And there's triangles and squares, and these might be, you know, these are part of this thing I'm talking about, like the way mathematics works, or how you know, some beauty in nature no one's in charge of, right? How come shells have these beautiful patterns? You know, like you might pick up a seashell with this intricate, like looks like a design someone drew, and yet we know nobody drew that. It just happened because of the chemistry of this shell growing, and it's kind of emergent order mathematics. You know, I don't pretend to really understand how this works, but certain pigments happen and they go in certain patterns, and those kinds of patterns can be formed without anybody in charge. That's how you get these beautiful patterns in nature when nobody's behind it. In sexual selection, some animals deciding they like it, like the female peacocks, the peahens, they just like this excessive tail, you know, you know, a house sparrow likes, the females like the male birds with a big black patch under their neck, but it's just a little bit of color. The rest of the bird is kind of brown and camouflaged and moves around fast. It doesn't have this excess. But, you know, somewhere in the world are sparrows with really long tails. They can barely fly. You know, in that species, they got carried away with their preferences. So it's like extreme aesthetics. You know, it's always a possibility tempered with against practicality, if that makes any sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, with the connection to visionary art, you know, there's this idea of form constant imagery. There has been studies on people who hallucinate, whether it be under the influence of psychedelics or in some other way, that the brain has a set number of patterns that are produced as visuals. These might be honeycombs, dots, lattice patterns, and these things seem to be, which are often expressed in visionary art, they seem to be of our nervous system, you know, which is why people who create art out of their psychedelic experience, a lot of the times the art looks very similar between a lot of different artists. It seems like there's a similar territory that all visionary artists go to, and that territory is influenced by the structure of our nervous system. I think that's so fascinating.
Yeah, and it's also influenced by what I was talking about, the emergent order of patterns. And no doubt this is what Plato was talking about when he said, the parable of the cave, the pure forms inside our brain are things we never actually see. They come from within us. So like our mind understands the perfect triangle, even though we can't draw one. We know what it is. You're never going to see one in the real imperfect world. But your mind is going to make these tessellating patterns and these senses of perfection. You can't explain it, but it sort of goes. And that's similar to how patterns are formed on shells. And it may have something to do with why certain patterns are favored by these few creatures that like really complicated sounds. But a lot sometimes it overlaps between, the order of some being doing something and the patterns of nature itself. For example, my next project involves listening to underwater sounds in ponds. And if you stick an underwater microphone in a pond, you hear this amazingly crazy music, much of it made by insects, but also plants exchanging oxygen with the air underwater. And some of those sounds are like the like if you open a fizzy drink and you see the bubbles in rhythm appearing. Sonically, you hear that, and no, nobody's doing that, but it all makes sense. You hear these rhythms. It's like a groove. It's like electronic music. No one's actually in charge except water, plants, like the fact that nature follows rhythm in the way it works, mixed together with creatures also making similar sounds. So I don't know if this makes any sense to you, but I can give you examples. So sometimes you hear like, oh, those insects are really jamming together, and then some expert will say, look, that's just a bunch of plants. Nobody's doing anything here. Like, oh, but it's there. The rhythms are there, and that's kind of just like artwork. It's a mixture of imagery from inside your mind, but also what you actually see or want to see. The mixture of things are going on in human perception. We don't always know where it's coming from.
Yeah, and it seems like different species select for different patterns, different aesthetic senses. I think there's a very peculiar animal called the bowerbird, and there are multiple species of bowerbird. And the bowerbirds create like art installations of twigs and stones and shells to attract mates. And McGregor bowerbirds create Christmas tree-like structures, and satin bowerbirds create tunnel-like structures. And my question is like, how much of the aesthetic sense between different species of bowerbirds is learned, and how much of it is genetically specific?
Yeah, that's a great example. And this is an example that puzzles everyone and is really going to upset a biologist who thinks all of this idea of aesthetics is wrong. And it's so commonly thought of as being wrong is that often you'll see the artworks of bowerbird mistakenly called nests. These are not the nests. They make other things for nests. These are artworks the males make only for the purpose of impressing the females, who, as you might imagine, mostly are not very impressed by it. They just look at it, go, eh, and go away. But how could this evolve? The bowerbirds do not learn how to do this. Genetically, they know. So genetically, they have inside them, ah, I'm going to wake up, I'm going to make this thing. I need to make it. It's like,
And they have a natural
ET.
sense of
Yeah,
what
yeah.
looks good, too.
They know, the satin bowerbird is not going to make the Christmas tree one. It's going to make them. Satin bowerbird's the only one I've seen in the wild making this. But the first time I saw a satin bowerbird bower, I just, in the middle of the wilderness in Australia, there was just a pile of plastic spoons in the middle of nowhere that were blue. It's like, who would leave blue plastic spoons here? And this guy said, oh, that's just what's left of the bowerbird's work. Like, what are you talking about? Like plastic spoons? Yeah, they would rather have blue flowers, but if they see a blue plastic spoon, they're going to grab it. I said, what? And then I later saw this, it's quite common. This satin bowerbirds like a blue jay. They're everywhere in people's backyards building these crazy things. And then you really get to wonder, it's like, there's some crazy things in nature we don't understand. And so the bowerbird is a species that makes an artwork and must do it and is born with this idea in its brain that I've got to build something like this. They steal from each other, but they don't learn to do this. A satin bowerbird will see another bird's bower and steal a bunch of blue things from it. And then each species has a whole different thing. How did this possibly happen? You know, biologists will point out only in Australia and New Guinea, where there's no predators, could such a thing have evolved. Otherwise, a predator would just pick up these birds, destroy the bower, and just nab them, you know, because it's so exposed. Like the artist is working on his site day after day after day, and there's no predators, so this extreme stuff could have evolved. So there is a book about this by a biologist, of course, arguing, an Australian biologist, this is why Australia has the best birds in the world. We're just better than everyone else because we have no predators and they can evolve extreme stuff. Like humans don't have too many predators. That's why we could evolve this whole crazy, ridiculous civilization that requires so much to survive. You know, if there was, imagine there were these big creatures that could just bite us and kill us that were everywhere and we were
We'd be
hiding in fear
burrowed.
from them. Yeah, we would never have been able to get so far.
Yeah. Now it's funny that you mentioned the bowerbirds preferring blue, because there's one point of continuity that I see between bowerbirds and human beings, is that the bowerbirds like blue because that's a more rare color to be found in nature, and they ascribe value to more scarce things. And it seems like that's similar in humans too. We apply more value to things that are more scarce, like precious metals
Well,
and
that's just one
diamonds.
theory about the satin bowerbird. I mean, the spotted bowerbird likes white stuff, white shells. They're everywhere. And the satin bowerbird's a little bluish himself. So maybe he wants to intensify his bluishness. No one really knows. And you know, a more mainstream biologist will explain like it's all very pragmatic and want a reason for everything. And then a more aesthetically minded biologist will say, whatever. They just like weird stuff. Like there's one a bowerbird, the one with the most elaborate, artwork in New Guinea, whose name's I'm forgetting right now. It might be Archibald's Bowerbird or something, but it's so complicated and convoluted. It looks like a weird art installation that a very experimental artist would make. One color here, a pile of this, a pile of that there, like a really complex, confusing thing. That's the most elaborate one, and those are, you can't really. You wonder how such a thing managed to evolve. Does it mean this bird is more advanced because he needs a makes a more complicated bower? I don't know. You know, some other one, someone might say they're less advanced because the more advanced ones are more efficient. And is the more advanced bird the most common one that survives everywhere, or the one that's so particular they can barely live anywhere in the world?
Yeah, who's
You
to
know.
say? They just have their own, they have their own sense, they have their own taste in art,
You know,
perhaps.
yeah, these different species have their own aesthetic sense. Each one's a world in itself. Like around here, the bird with the most complicated song is the mockingbird. They're just going to start singing pretty soon, if they haven't already, around Kasem. And those songs are very organized, very musical, and really following a clear sense of structure. Nobody would doubt that. But no human has bothered to articulate what that structure is. That's something I'm working on right now with some scientists. Because there's a guy, a biologist, Dave Gammon in North Carolina. He's like the world mockingbird connoisseur. He listens to a mockingbird. He can tell you every sound that's being imitated, which ones that are not imitations. He knows so much about them. He doesn't really realize it, that it's like aesthetic knowledge. He thinks it's scientific knowledge, but it's actually an aesthetic sense of what these birds are doing. He's a master of. And so I just listen to the recording, listen to him talk about it. I explain what I'm hearing there, and he gives me the details because he knows them. And it's like it's a very convol it's very specialized, but I mean, I would say the important thing about it is most people who hear mockingbirds say, oh, this sounds very organized and musical, but if you we wanted to know how is it organized, nobody has much to say about that. And so that's what we're gonna say.
I was interested. I was watching your BBC documentary, and it mentioned that there are some birds who are constantly trying to generate original songs because the females get habituated to a song and they want to stay excited. The males want to keep their interest. But there are also birds that are experts at mimicry. There are birds that focus on originality, and others that focus on copying. Can you talk about this difference a little bit more and why one bird would prefer originality over mimicry or vice versa?
Yeah, I mean, what is mimicry exactly? These are birds whose in their repertoire of sounds imitate the sounds of other birds. And to this, the mockingbird is the great master. In fact, we call it the mockingbird. He's just copying everyone else. But it isn't really true. He uses the sounds of everyone else and puts them together in this very specialized way. And that's what's the mockingbird's genius. It's as if he's thinking about all the other sounds around and messing with them, morphing them, sampling them. He's an original sampler. And so, I mean, biologists would say, why does mimicry exist? They say it's an easy way to generate novelty and variety. You hear something in your environment and you copy it. But then others will say, look, if it was so easy, how come so few birds do it? If it's that easy a strategy, why is it the rarity, the exception rather than the rule? So it may just be a certain way of relating to one's sonic environment that most species don't end up evolving the idea to do. And so, you know, the section of originality and sameness is quite interesting. Like, we know that certain bird species, they try and sound, every individual wants to sound different from the others, so he's recognized. But they also have the sense of competitiveness sometimes. They learn a lot of the sounds the other ones are doing and say, I know all these sounds, but I know something else, you know. But I would say there's an overemphasis among scientists in more being better. This bird has more songs, then he must be better. And my hunch is that that's not likely to be true. If there's a sense of competition with all these songs, there must be a better and worse song. So, for example, the white-throated sparrow goes doo 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 doo. That's a common song. Some people think they're saying, oh, Sam Peabody, 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 or oh, sweet Canada, Canada, Canada. That's how we remember it. But they're making these sounds, and there's actually a lot of diversity of how all the individuals do it. But as we listen, there seems to be this ideal sound that they're sort of working towards, that they all try to aspire to, and that we might imagine there might be a perfect version of this that all the birds will like. And certain species of birds, cardinals, for example, it's been found if you play a synthesized, more pure version of their song to them, they get really excited. Like, they prefer it to what they can make because the real world is imperfect. Like, a synthesized sound can be more perfect than an acoustic sound. And some people love that aspect of electronic music, and others find it like it's kind of hollow or unreal. But the birds, you know, the cardinals go, what? You know, they sense it's more pure than what they can do. They get excited about this. And that's something that has been noted. Like, but, you know, other species might not be so interested in. They all have a different aesthetic sense that is in some senses, it's like what's they're born with this sense. In another sense, they learn how to deal with it. You know, there's a mixture of learning and genetics when it comes to bird sounds.
Now, I'm interested in the kind of environments that are most conducive to creativity, not just for humans, but for birds too. It seems to me that birds sing the most at dawn. Why is that true, and why is that? Are they singing because they're celebrating the sun coming up one more day? In what situations do birds sing the most?
Yeah, I mean, it's absolutely true that in many parts of the world, most birds sing the most at dawn. Even right before dawn, they begin. It's also true, if you're going to be honest, like, humans have no idea why this is. We don't know. Science does not know. Everything is a hypothesis. And it's very hard to test. It's very hard to figure out. And that's, I think, I'm always excited by things we don't know. Like, what are the hypotheses? There's many interesting ones. One is that it's too early to go get food. Let's sing, you know. That's one hypothesis. Another one is, you know, they're announcing, look, I'm still here. Like, hello.
Roll call.
The day begins. I'm still here.
Yeah.
Another hypothesis is sound travels better then. There's less other noise. And and the air, the way the air molecules work means sound works better at dawn. But all these are hypotheses. A more spiritual hypothesis is that the plants need birdsong to grow. this one is not scientifically proven or likely to ever be proven, but it's something you hear about. So, and it may be true, but there's no scientific evidence that it's true.
I have heard that.
Yeah. And so you know, I'm just telling you like the honest state of things.
It's still a mystery.
But the main thing is that we don't know, and we also really don't know whether the bird species listen to each other. There's been very little study of that, like cardinals listening to sparrows, mockingbirds listening to catbirds. We tend to, the classic view is that they don't. They only listen to their own species sounds. But most people who listen to the dawn chorus or any group of birds singing says, whoa, they do seem to be responding to each other. And it may be this kind of collective listening that we have to think more about.
Wow.
And now that scientists can analyze huge amounts of data, you can leave a recorder out for weeks recording everything that happens. They're using their scientific mathematical tools. They're able to come up with some ideas about this now. Because, you know, the intuition of a musician is like, ah, it all connects. I hear it. I want to join in. But the scientist wants to calculate everything. It doesn't mean one is right and the other is wrong. It just means they have different criteria for truth. That's what I say over and over again. What's the difference between what scientists hear in a bird song, what a musician hears, what a mystic hears? Each one has a different criteria for what's real, what's true. Mm. And no one is better than the other, you know. And you have to combine them all to realize all the stuff that, all the possibilities that humanity has to learn.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Now, my next question, it's a fun one.
Okay,
you've experimented extensively with interspecies communication with birds, insects, and whales. What have you learned from your studies of that that might be applied to one day communicating with alien intelligence?
That's good. Yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, I think of John Lilly saying the aliens are right here under the sea. You know, let's communicate with them, you know. He was a legendary crazy dolphin scientist. And, you know, we still can't really communicate very well with all these animals. So the lessons are, you know, the communication I'm interested in is very specific in that I'm interested in the music rather than the language. So I don't necessarily want to decode what any of these animals are doing, because I pick these sounds that are closer to music than to language. And what I mean by that is, by studying the nature of these patterns, it's pretty clear to us that, say, the mockingbird, the humpback whale, the nightingale, they're not conveying a lot of information in their sounds. They're just putting patterns together the way music is put together for its own sake, in a way. You know, in its own sense, it makes sense. It's not that we're going to decode the whale song and say, oh, this whale is telling me where he's been. He went here and here and here. This kind of information you don't find in, say, instrumental music. It's just notes. It's patterns. They're not standing for anything. It's not like a secret code. It's a rule, patterns that are about themselves. They convey emotion rather than information. And so it's quite possible that we would have an easier time making music with the aliens than talking to them. That happens in Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
Yes.
Like the music crosses lines and it's about itself, you know, if that makes any sense. And that's why once you say the birds are musicians, I want to play with them, then a contact is possible. Whereas it's like they're saying things I don't understand, I wish I could translate, then it's impossible. So we're going to be able to make music with the aliens long before we'll be able to speak with them.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, music and mathematics, which are two very much in and of the same, seem to be the best attempt at a universal language. You know, like mathematics is something that must be in some way constant because it's so real, you could say.
Yeah, I remember when they sent the golden record out of our solar system towards the aliens, they included music and they included some mathematical visual things saying this is the kind of stuff that maybe could cross species lines and be understood. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, you know, there could be many different things about aliens' intelligences that they may have inside their brains, different patterns than the ones we have.
Yeah.
And they might have a different sense of what an object is and what the laws of the world are. We don't know, you know.
Yeah. Wow. Well, My next question kind of comes back to this idea of sexual selection and the implications that it has for the debate over the existence of free will, a seemingly timeless debate. Many materialist scientists and new atheist types like Richard Dawkins and Sam Harris have a very deterministic view of evolution. They look at evolution as a boulder rolling down a mountain that may change course as it hits a tree on the way down, but it has no choice in its path, no free will. But the idea of sexual selection seems to undermine that theory because it proves that consciousness or free will, the ability to make choice, most often in the form of female choice, actually affects the course of evolution, that we don't just adapt to the physical environment, that we adapt to the social environment. So my question for you is, do you believe that the discerning and aesthetic role that female birds play in evolution in the evolution of their species proves the existence of free will?
That's a good question. I mean, before that, I think, you know, nobody should think evolution is deterministic. Mm-hmm. Anyone who thinks that just doesn't get it. Like if we rewound evolution back a few million years, set it loose again, we'd get completely different animals, maybe solving the same problems, but different ways. And this is because evolution is based on random mutation, randomness, things that go in surprising directions. So I'd be surprised if any of those people really thought that evolution was that deterministic. Where they do sometimes go, though, is to think that everyone is like a cog in this machine. We think we're being free, but we're actually fulfilling these necessary, you know, roles and stuff. And that, I think, is... I would disagree with that. All animals, whoever they are, they're all individuals. Everyone's an individual and can do what you don't expect. No animal is a little machine doing what it's supposed to do. Surprise is always possible. It could happen at any moment. And yes, of course, you know, these female birds develop a strange aesthetic senses as a species. They're not deciding. It just kind of happens. So the preference at some point, you know, I guess I don't really feel I know the answer where the decision happens. Where was there one point when these peacocks said, yeah, we want more, 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 more? Or did it just happen by many instances? Remember, there's free will in the choice by any female who decides who to mate with. You know, that's a decision. Like, I prefer you. I don't prefer you. You know, that's a sense of decision. You can't deny that that's going on.
Yeah, I mean, and one definition of consciousness is that which makes choices, you know? And if there are choices being made, then that seems to implicate the existence of free will, as opposed to, like you say, just deterministic.
There's certainly free will in lots of these animals. They decide to do this or that. And, you know, those with very simple nervous systems are still making decisions like that. I mean, I think... you know, you don't, the sense of consciousness where humans are the ones who reflect on the meaning of their existence, that might not be going on so much in the animal world. The sense of self-questioning, like, why am I here? Who am I? What does this all mean? That might be a uniquely human predicament. But the sense of free will saying, should I go left? Should I go right? Should I mate with this guy or this one? You know, this is decisions made all the time. Animals are not responding automatically. Insects might be. Insects, it's more like the whole population of insects is like a collective mind. The individuals, they behave more like these little machines that, you know, Descartes thought all animals were. Like a certain sound will get all the insects to respond. Like, you know, cicadas do like the sounds of lawnmowers. Will get them going. You know, they don't have to think about it too much. It just sort of happens.
It's reflexive.
Yeah, it's sort of in their mechanism. When they hear a certain kind of sound, they respond to it.
Wow. Well, hey, David, I think that's a great place to wrap it up. Thank you so much for talking with me today.
Thanks a lot, Tyler. And you asked a lot of good questions. And if you want any of these musical examples, like the whale and the bird and stuff, or any of these things, just ask. I can send them to you.
Thanks again for listening to the Cosm Podcast. To stay up to date on any future podcasts, be sure to follow Chapel of Sacred Mirrors on Instagram and Facebook. And to learn more, visit cosm.org.
To learn more about David Rothenberg, check out all his books that are available on Amazon, or you can go to davidrothenberg.net. And thank you so much to everyone who has made a donation during this time. Every donation is a stand for the future of COSM and allows us to continue to bring awesome podcasts like this to the community. Be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel if you haven't already, and tell us in the comments who else you'd like to see on future podcasts or what subjects you'd like to see explored by Alex and Allison. Thank you to Deca for the soundtrack to this podcast. You can find Deca on YouTube, Spotify, and Bandcamp. Now, let's watch a clip of David Rothenberg play his clarinet in a duet with a humpback whale in Hawaii.
Going out to meet the whales and make some music with them. Come on.
Happy.